Stacey Connaughton. I'm a professor in the Brian Lamb School of Communication and the director of the Purdue Policy Research Institute, or PPRI, as we call it here at Purdue. PPRI is so pleased to have this opportunity to co-host this lecture series with the Center for Tech Diplomacy at Purdue, as well as the Office of Global Partnerships and the Colleges of Engineering and Liberal Arts. The Ambassador Distinguished Lecture Series at Purdue was developed to bring ambassadors and other distinguished diplomats into the Purdue University community to share their firsthand knowledge and experiences on a diversity of topics related to diplomatic challenges and opportunities, particularly in areas where Purdue has capacity to affect positive change. The series invites an engagement with real-world issues across disciplines of science, technology, engineering, and agriculture, along with the social sciences and humanities. Today, we are again so delighted to have with us Brazilian Ambassador Nestor Forster Jr. to speak about Brazilian diplomacy in innovation, technology, and agritech. At this time, I am delighted to introduce the Honorable Bonnie Glick, who will in turn introduce the ambassador. As the former Deputy Administrator and Chief Operating Officer of the U.S. Agency for International Development, and with her extensive experience in diplomacy and in industry, as well as university communities, we are so fortunate to have her here at Purdue. Bonnie, please come to the podium to introduce the ambassador.
Thank you, Stacey. That's so very kind. And I really appreciate the welcome here every time I come to Purdue. This is like a wonderful break from where I live in Washington, D.C. As Lucas just said from the Brazilian embassy, there's so much space here. And it's really true in Indiana, in the heartland of the United States. There's a lot of space, there's a lot of green space, a lot of activity that fills that space. And we feel it every time we come to campus and we have an opportunity to interact with students, with faculty, and with people who are live streaming with us. And it will be taking questions as well on the link online. We're so happy to have all of you who are able to join us here in person. It is so wonderful to be able to see faces and to engage with both the faculty and the student body in an area that's so important to the world, which is innovation. Brazil is uniquely positioned as a country that is at the leading edge of innovation. And Ambassador Forster here in the United States has innovation and Brazil's unique expertise in areas around innovation as one of the key structures of Brazil's diplomatic representation here in the United States and around the world. Ambassador Forster is uniquely positioned to fill this role for us here in the United States to present Brazilian innovation. He has served numerous tours of duty here in the United States, not just in Washington, D.C., but in Hartford, Connecticut, in the Brazilian consulate, as well as in New York. And it is my, and he's also served in Canada and in Costa Rica. So he is really learned in the Americas, North America and South America. For us, it is a unique pleasure to invite Ambassador Forster here to talk to us at Purdue University about innovation diplomacy, Brazil's position in this role as a leader in the global economy, global development, and in global diplomacy. Mr. Ambassador, thank you so much for coming here. And please, we're all excited to hear from you.
Thank you very much, Bonnie Glick, for that kind introduction. I'd like to thank everyone who worked to organize this event here tonight. I want to thank Dean Chang and Dr. Conathan, who's going to be speaking with us. I thank Dr. Flavio Ribeiro for his warm welcome, and Dr. Donna Weinstein, with whom we met earlier today. I also want to thank President Mitch Daniels for a very warm welcome. Let me tell you something. This is not working, so we'll be aside. This is, for me, it's a bit of a dream come true to be at Purdue tonight with you and to be able to tell you a little bit about my country. And I think it will become clear why I say it's a dream come true. If we take into account the long history of cooperation of this institution with institutions in my country and the great fruits it has produced so far. And we look forward to having an even bigger harvest in the years to come. What I'll talk to you about tonight, the topic here is innovation and technology and agtech and so on. Before we jump into that, I don't like to speak on a void, on an ether. Before we can innovate, we need to have, you know, something to innovate from. So I'd like to share with you just a brief a set of slides here that I call Brazil Update. Very brief, mentioning where we are today in economic terms. Also like to touch on a very momentous discussions about climate change and the environment and so on, and the many things we read in the press about Brazil, not always accurate, I must add. And I'd like to set the record straight for you tonight. And then I'll delve into the topic of, you know, what we've been trying to do in what we call innovation diplomacy, which involves the works of many units of the Brazilian government around the world. We have over 200 representations around the globe. And of course, I'm going to be focusing on what we're trying to do in the United States, Embassy in Washington, and the network of consulates we have in this country, which is about 10 different cities, including the great city of Chicago and the next door here to Indiana. Let me start just by highlighting, you know, what we've done in terms of the recovery from the pandemic. I'm not going to talk about the health issues. That's mostly taken care of. Thanks be to God. You know, just want to bring to you the information that, you know, our economy is picking up strongly last year with a recovering lost ground during the pandemic. We have a very robust growth of 4.6% in 2021. You know, a huge increase in foreign direct investment in Brazil, Brazil being one of the countries, especially in the developing world, which attracted most foreign investment. We also had a huge effort from the government in trying to help those most hurt by the pandemic, including people who could not stay home in their pajamas and with their laptops, needed to go out, you know, win the bread for their families. So there was a strong fiscal impact, especially during 2020 in Brazil. And we are glad to report that we have recovered and we are in a very solid fiscal position this year. The labor market is picking up and unemployment is down significantly. And most importantly, and this is a direct impact for our relation with the United States and even with the state of Indiana specifically, is that after a fall in our foreign trade in 2020, pandemic related, it picked up strongly. We had an increase of 35% in our bilateral trade with the United States last year, and including with Indiana, which jumped over 20%. I was just checking the numbers. We had a bilateral trade Brazil, state of Indiana, of $1.2 billion last year. From the economy, I just want to talk a little bit about the Amazon. You know, we cannot talk about Brazil and not talk about one of the greatest natural assets we have in our country. It's not the only one, but it's certainly the greatest. And the first thing I like to point out, so people don't get misled about the Amazon is on fire and the tipping point because a road is going to be built, etc., is that the Amazon, what you see there with the flags on the north part of Brazil, it equals six times the size of the largest American state, which is the state of Texas. So the Amazon equals the Brazilian Amazon equals six times the state of Texas. You could also say that it equals six times the size of Ukraine. Texas and Ukraine have about the same area of territory. So the Amazon is six Ukraines. Ukraine, the second largest country in Europe, as we all know. Of that, we have a very important part of that is very well preserved. Actually, it's over 80% of the Amazon is untouched. And I'm going to explain to you a bit more about that. It has a lot to do with what we see here. I don't know if you can, in the back, can read what's in there. This shows, you know, for the Amazon biome, what we do here and, you know, the amount of areas which are protected areas by law. That's, you know, some part of it is indigenous reservations, indigenous lands, 25%. About 28% are, I'm sorry, 16% conservation units. We're talking about national parks and preservation areas. And about 28% is a very unique thing that we have in Brazil, which is a requirement of our forestry code that if you own land in the Amazon, you can only work on 20% of the land you own. 80% must be put aside, must retain its original vegetation. So that amounts for 28% of the preservation we have in the Amazon. These are private citizens who are playing a great role in terms of preservation, keeping the forest standing. And we've been working in many ways, including in multilateral fora, such as the Paris Agreement. You saw the conference we had in Glasgow last November, in seeing, trying to find new ways, creative ways to remunerate these people. So they have no incentives not to follow our law. It's very strict. You have nothing similar in any other part of the world, you know, requiring you to keep 80% of your property on the side. So if you put it, everything together, you put the light greens and the hard greens together, you get to 84.1%, I think, is which is protected and preserved areas in the Amazon. So to give you, you know, just an overview, that that tremendous asset supports what, you know, the United Nations say it's the largest biodiversity of any country in the world. We're very proud of that. We have between 15 and 20% of all the species in the world are there in Brazil in general. It's been, you know, a large extent in the Amazon. Over 100,000 species of animals, 40,000 species of plants. And what I like about this, aside from the pink dolphin, which is one of my favorite animals, and you can only find it in the Amazon River. I've been there, I saw it. It's really, you know, incredible. As smart as their cousin from the seas, but, you know, pink, all pink. Male and female, all pink. It's very funny. Now, what I like, I was going to say, is that even though we have this tremendous biodiversity, it's growing year after year. There are about 700 new species of animals which are discovered every year in Brazil, specifically in the Amazon. So it's not shrinking. It's growing stronger. So this is what we bring to the table, the preservation of 84% of the Amazon, which is, you know, almost half of the Brazilian territory with this great biodiversity. Then we move to energy. And I like to highlight this, you know, I'm sorry about bragging a little bit, but I have to face up lots of criticism, which we find unwarranted. So we need to talk about the good things. And I'm not bringing to you propaganda. These are hard data. You can all verify. It's all sourced. If it's not sourced here, we'll provide you with the source. So this is Brazil's energy mix. And we say that we are today where many countries, many more advanced countries have pledged to be in 15 or 20 years. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the fact that about half of all the energy consumed in Brazil comes from renewable sources, half of all the energy. If you look at into electricity, electric sector in Brazil, that's 85% comes from renewable sources. Large part of that is hydro, about 60-something percent, but you have biofuels, you have a growing role played by wind. About 10% of our energy comes from windmills. And we have new projects to increase that. I'm going to talk about when we get into the technology part of it. But you can see it's something, you know, to be proud of to some extent. This combination of, you know, environmental assets, the biodiversity supports, what are we doing with the energy, and of course, this has a direct impact on the environment, a positive impact. Let's move on to our main topic here, and then we'll delve into some of the specifics, the connections I want to make, including with your great institution here of Purdue University. So, you know, we have a scene in Brazil which is very vibrant in terms of innovation. We went, see the numbers there, we went with the number of startups in 2015 from 3,000, we went to 13,000 in 2021. So a little over 5 years, we almost quadrupled the number of startups. The investment growing up tremendously as well. Brazil has been a leader in the number of unicorns. We are number three in the world in 2019. 2021, we had our first decacorn, a new word for me. I don't know, the younger part of our audience here might be familiar with that. That's when a unicorn reaches $10 billion, so they call it decacorn. I just learned the word recently. And, you know, Brazil has more than half, 60% of all Latin American unicorns. I'm going to be talking a bit later about one almost unicorn, which is currently housed in this university and which we had the pleasure and the honor to visit this afternoon. And I learned a lot there. I want to share something of that with you. Just let me highlight what we've been trying to do in terms of what we call innovation diplomacy. As I said, we try to use, you know, the resources we have, our diplomatic representations and consulates around the world. We have 215, 220 different offices in you know, mostly every country. And we have a program which we've been using for the past 5 years. We call it innovation program diplomacy. And it has just a basic ideas of what we try to do in terms of specifically attracting investments, identifying opportunities between countries. And of course, the US has a very important role to play with its own innovation ecosystem, which is supposed to be one of the most vibrant dynamic in the world. So we try to identify, you know, whatever synergies, partnerships can be developed between Brazilian companies, American companies, how we can attract investment in high-tech areas to Brazil. We try to support, not that it's wrong in their internalization, the internationalization of, it's a long word, of startups. And of course, promoting, you know, high-tech products, services, and so on. Among those, our agricultural products, I'd say. But one of the most important aspects is what you see on the right side, the diaspora mobilization. So we have this expression, this Brazilian scientific science and technology diaspora, meaning people like Dr. Ribeiro here, who have left Brazil and have studied a lot, you know, master's, doctorate, postdoc studies, et cetera, in great American universities, and have come to great positions here, heading important research centers. And that we think that these people play a very important role in trying to make these connections that I mentioned between, you know, Brazilian companies, Brazilian research institutions, and so on. And these people, these Brazilians who are here in the US, they agree with us on that. And that's why we have this annual event that we host at the embassy, usually at the end of the year, early December. Of course, with the pandemics, we had to miss that last 2 years, but we are very excited to try to do it this year. I have with me here, let me briefly introduce to you my colleague, Lucas Frota. Lucas heads our section entirely devoted to promoting investment and in increasing trade between our countries, you know, exports, imports, both sides. And Lucas also helped us organize this meeting. We have a sector at the Embassy for Science and Technology, which plays a role here. And we usually bring around, about 100 people from around the country to Washington, D.C. We have the Science and Technology Diaspora Award, which we give at this occasion. But most of all, we promote big workshops, you know, focused on specific issues on how we can increase the connections, the synergies there, the networking. So, you know, I hope to see some of you perhaps there later this year in DC when we do this. Specifically, you know, about the work, the agenda of our embassy here, as Director Bonnie Glick mentioned at the get-go here, this is an important part of what we try to do. And we're very proud of what we achieved last year when Brazil was the first Latin American country to join the so-called Artemis Project. I assume most of you will be familiar with it, at least from your Greek mythology readings. You know, Artemis was the sister of Apollo. So that's why Artemis is the project that will take the first woman to the moon. And then beyond the project is supposed to go to Mars later on, based on whatever can be done in terms of a lunar base to do that. So Brazil has joined the project, and we are meeting actually next week. There's a meeting between the Brazilian Space Agency and NASA to look into ways how we can, you know, do concrete things about this, bringing the private sectors on both sides. And we see enormous potential because it's space. And there are data out there. You who are more familiar with technology must know this data better than I do. But for every dollar you put, you invest in technology in space, the multiplying effect is usually several times larger than in other areas. It has 1,400 projects already identified within Artemis. Brazil is thinking about two things, you know. One is launching a nanosatellite to orbit the moon and from the lunar orbit to observe the climate on Earth. There are special things you can do about the climate on Earth from a lunar perspective, if you will, that you cannot do from an Earth orbit. So that's one thing. And that will involve a great institution we have in Brazil, which is the Air Force Technological Institute, ITA, Instituto Tecnológico da Aeronáutica, just outside São Paulo in São José dos Campos. And that's where our aeronautics industry started, Embraer, connected to that. And with a great story of connection to the United States, this is not with Purdue University, but the MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which was the embryo of our own technological institute. And today we have their Embraer, the third largest cluster of aerospace industry anywhere in the world after Boeing here and the Airbus consortium in Europe. And we have some 300 companies that are based there in São José dos Campos. We want to bring, the whole purpose is to bring, you know, more projects, more viability to about 10% of those companies which directly related to space. And we have many startups in that area as well. So we're looking into ways how to make that, maximize that potential. And the other project, and this is very dear to my heart, I have my little diplomatic dream, is to do that robotic vehicle that's mentioned there, which would conduct mineral experiments on the surface of the moon. We're talking with different Brazilian companies which might have an interest in supporting the project. But my diplomatic dream about this would be that, you know, NASA is scheduled to land on the moon in 2024. There might be a revision of that date. We would hope that they would be able to keep it, because in 2024, Brazil and the U.S. are going to celebrate 200 years of unbroken diplomatic relations. The U.S. was one of the first countries to recognize Brazil's independence, President Monroe, back in 1824. John Quincy Adams was then Secretary of State, played an important role in that. And I think it would be, you know, very significant for both our countries to have this lunar vehicle with both flags flying there, you know, signifying this unbroken two centuries of friendship. Brazil doesn't have that with any country in the world, with any other country in the world. But what about your South American neighbors? We have great relations with all our 10 neighbors in South America. We recently, a young colleague of mine in the foreign ministry, found out that actually Argentina recognized Brazil's independence ahead of the United States for 3 months. You know, he spent, you know, many hours in libraries and looking into old documents and so on. And he found that. And that's nice. Okay. It was late in 1823. But the sad thing about this is that the relationship with Argentina was broken just 2 years later. In 1825, we went to war with them, when the Cisplatine War, which ended up creating Uruguay and so on. And again, in 1850, I'm not going to delve too much into that. The special thing with the U.S., 200 years of unbroken, you know, relations with, you know, great moments, very close moments, others not so much. But the friendship element has always been there, you know, based on these values we share of, you know, democratic values, the rule of law, economic freedom, respect for human rights. You know, perhaps a few years ago, this kind of talk would sound very abstract. And that's the way diplomats talk about these abstract concepts. But in the world we live in today, I think we can see how concrete these things are and how they bring countries together. Especially in moments of, challenges and crisis. So, as I said before, the diaspora played a very important role, plays a very important role in approaching research institutions in both our countries. And, of course, this institution here played a very important role. I don't know if you're all familiar with how deep those ties go. It goes all the way back to the 1950s. When the first missions from Purdue University went to Brazil, they went specifically to a university which was nascent back then. It's called Viçosa University in the state of Minas Gerais. And before I went to the airport this morning, I was speaking with our Minister of Agriculture, a great lady called Teresa Cristina. And I was telling her, look, I'm going to fulfill my dream of visiting Purdue University, had this great invitation. And she said, oh, they did a great thing. And they did a great thing for my alma mater, for the university I went to, which is Viçosa. So you see the connection there, and you see the fruits in many forms. This is one of them. So if you look at Brazil, what was going on in Brazil agriculture in the 50s and 60s, you see, you know, a very low-tech operation, low productivity, very hard time finding the right seeds, the right techniques to plant in our tropical climate, our tropical environment. That's when, you know, these the influence of Purdue began to be felt, with these people having a new outlook on how to do things in agriculture. People, nobody talked about ag tech back then, I'm sure, but, you know, they're doing just that. They're bringing technology into agriculture. And in 1972, a Brazilian research company was created. It was, created as a state company. They had something different. It was not one more state company where you put your, you know, relatives in good jobs. It was created with a very, let's say, private sector outlook. It was organized like a private company. That's part of its success. That's why I highlighted. And then you see that beginning, you know, from the early, first years, leaders from Embrapa came to study here in West Lafayette in Purdue University. And, you know, this connection never stopped. She had begun in the 1950s, 60s with Viçosa, then Embrapa connected with Purdue. And the people who studied here, who did a master's doctorate here, they took to Brazil this novel idea of having a scientific approach to agriculture, so-called science-based agriculture, right? And what we did was to adapt whatever they learned here in terms of agricultural techniques and try to apply that to the specific conditions of the Brazil ecosystems, you know, mostly tropical, not all tropical part of it is temperate. And there you have the numbers and how it has increased. You know, since 2000, we have multiplied by three the number of Brazilian students here in Purdue. I was just talking to Dr. Chang that we need to multiply that by 10, perhaps, you know. There's even a mission going from the university here in June to Brazil to try to help promote that rapprochement. And, you know, we are all for it. One more fruit here of this great cooperation. If you look back in the 1970s, Brazil was a net importer of foodstuffs, meaning Brazil could not feed its own population. 50 years later, the picture has changed a bit. You see there are some of the main crops and some of, you know, protein groups there. And if you look at the middle column there, you know, the first one is production. The second one is exports. So Brazil is the first in sugar, coffee, orange juice, soybean, beef, poultry, second in corn, fourth in pork. So that's really impressive. And how it be, what accounts for that? You know, part of it is this institution, the cooperation we had, science-based agriculture, which does great things for the environment as well. Let me move on here. So you see here, I just like to highlight this to see, you know, what it means in very practical terms. So if you look at the crops, between 76 to 2016, we had a 400% increase in our agricultural production, 400%. So it's doubling every 10 years, right? And what about the amount of soil you're using for it, the resources that you use, land used for it? It increased only by a third. So it's an incredible disparity. Look at the graph on the right. You see that flat line at the bottom. That's the area used for crops in Brazil. You see the red line going up, that's output, production. The disparity is what's called productivity, right? You're using basically the same the same amount of land and you're producing several times more. If you look into livestock, as you know, is very land intensive and gets blamed a lot for whatever people don't like about Brazil. But if you look at this is a hard data, you know, between 1990 and 2018, and we could update it to today, we have an increase of about 140% in our beef production, 140% increase. What about the land usage? It declined. It declined 15%. How do you explain that? Productivity. You're harvesting the beef earlier. You have more advanced techniques for production, for insemination, species selection, et cetera, you end up with this, which is good for the environment. It's good for food security around the world. In the case of beef, it's good for our Sunday barbecues as well. I'm very fond of that in the part of Brazil where I'm from, if you let me make that joke. So, yeah. And, you know, according to the USDA here in the U.S., you see the graph there at the bottom, Brazil is the country which had the largest increase in productivity in the last 20 years among the biggest agricultural production countries. So, talking about the environment, this is a graph that shows the amount of cropland used in countries. Look at Brazil there at the bottom. That's 7.6% for those of you who cannot read in the back. 7.6. You keep going up there. China is almost twice as much. The US, three times as much. Then you go to Europe. Look, it jumped from 7% in Brazil. Germany is over 50% of their territory is used for crops. And you can go, you know, 60% in India. You go all the way in the Nordic countries. Ukraine there, 74%, et cetera. There's a tremendous environmental impact involved in that. So that's another, this highlights the importance of technology, of ag techs, of the cooperation I have mentioned here several times, which enables us to, with a small part of our territory, produce such a great output. So, you know, we have become a leader in the whole ag tech business of our very vibrant startup scene. We have about 1,500 focused specifically on ag tech. 90% of the investment on ag tech in Latin America goes to Brazil. And, you know, I just want to share with you, I'm taking too much time here, but this is almost the end, of what I saw here when I visited the technological center here at Purdue earlier this afternoon, this company called Solfintech. Solinftech. That's a funny name, Solinftech. I have to get a hold of it. Solinftech started, 10 years ago. They're almost a unicorn. They're getting there. And what they do is really something that we usually think, you know, when I make my presentations here, you think abstractly, you don't realize these things are already happening. What am I talking about? They are using all the inputs that go into the production of grains, for instance. They are using technology as much as technology as is available, meaning they equip whatever machines are there to disperse fertilizers or to sow seeds or to use crop remedies, whatever. These are all connected online and they apply, for instance, they apply fertilizers, they apply crop remedies according to sensors, which is basically artificial intelligence. It's not more one or two things being used, but it's a bunch of things intersecting, like, you know, the level of humidity, the whole meteorological outlook for the region at that specific moment. It's all in real time online. So it's spraying a crop remedy. It's taking into account the speed of the wind at that moment. You see, this sort of thing, this is done remotely, of course. This brings a degree of precision to agriculture, which agriculture never had. And I find it fascinating that if you think about, I'm very fond of the history of food. If you look at, how food production evolved throughout history, you see that these things that some of us like from, let's say, from the European countries, which have developed this appellation and this demarcation of land specifically to produce this wine or this cheese or this whatever kind of crop. This was developed over time. And, with one generation passing the little knowledge that they had of the terrain and the technique and this and that, took centuries to get to this very special wine or this very special cheese or whatever. Today, what we're seeing with the technological revolution, which has kind of standardizes everything, massively produced, et cetera, we are paradoxically seeing, and I just heard this afternoon, what they call decommoditization, which is going back to the old times, because people want to know, where did my cheese come from? What was the environmental impact? Are you cutting the rainforest to make my barbecue and so on? With technology, we can do that. There's a tremendous degree of traceability, and with that comes accountability. So I was really excited to see that. And I just want to wrap up here before too long with, what we've done. So I traced for you a brief picture of what we're trying to do here in terms of agriculture, of technology and the environment. And these are just highlighting some of the things we did with our commitments in terms of environmental preservation, climate change, and so on. This is how things evolved, but the important one is one on the right on Glasgow, how Brazil was able to increase its objectives. Just want to make the final point that these are not empty pledges. These are not just for show to, to appear nice at the picture. Oh, Brazil has committed to complete the energy transition by 2050, or has increased its national determined contribution to reduce its greenhouse gases from 43% compared to 2005, which is the base year, to 50% by 2030. You know, all these tremendous, tremendous advances. This is not for show. This is based in what I was telling you, mentioning it to you before here, agricultural technology and what Brazil already brings to the table in terms of our energy mix, of our environmental preservation. And the last thing, which is very new, that this zero methane program is announced 3 days ago by our Minister of the Environment and the President. And this is basically going to use methane emissions, which come from landfills, comes from livestock, from animal waste in livestock production, etc. They're going to use this to generate biogas and specifically biomethane. And the idea is to replace the diesel fuel that's used in buses and trucks around the country. Diesel plays a big role in transportation in Brazil. About 70% of it can be replaced by this new initiative, which of course is the Brazilian contribution to the reduction, so-called methane pledge, which we also did in Glasgow. This is just in a nutshell. We could talk much more. I'm sorry if I went a bit over time, but I thank you very much for your audience. And I'm ready to have a conversation and answer whatever questions you might have. Thank you. Put a gift for you. Yeah. Over here. Thank you.
All right. Well, we are getting settled into our chairs here. Please, I encourage you all to be thinking of questions to ask the ambassador and Director Glick based on our conversation so far, things that you are going to hear as we continue our conversation. And that also very much includes those of you listening to the live stream. Our dear friend Heidi Arola from the Office of Global Partnerships is going to be watching the chat. And so please do feel free to raise your hands proverbially online to ask some questions as well. Those of you here in the room, as a question occurs to you, please raise your hand. I encourage the students to do that very much, and we will call on you. Ambassador, thank you for such a wonderful and engaging conversation. I had heard that you were going to be engaging, and you did not disappoint. So thank you so very, very much. I wondered if you might, since we're at a university of higher education, what is one of the many wonderful things that you talked about that Brazil has done in the areas of tech diplomacy and innovation that you would like the United States to learn from Brazil?
In terms of, it's usually, can I use this mic? I have my own. Okay. Yeah,
perfect.
Thank you. It's usually, Dr. Cunzon, thank you for the question. It's usually the other way around, right? We are always thinking about what Brazil can learn with the US. And I totally get your point. It's a two-way street. Mm-hmm. And, I don't think I can point to one single specific thing. Perhaps this is what we've been trying to do with our diaspora. The thing is that the U.S. doesn't have a big diaspora. It's the other way around. You're a big magnet. You attract people here to study at the great American institutions. But perhaps, we have many people who have gone to Brazil in other areas. Perhaps getting that knowledge together, that can produce great results. It's our experience with our people here in the United States, at least.
Wonderful, wonderful. You know, Director Glick, this gives me an opportunity. You know, you were instrumental in bringing the ambassador here, you and Dean Chang, and the Center for Tech Diplomacy at Purdue, this series that you have founded and begun, and the center in general. Why did you all decide to do it, and why at Purdue?
I have a feeling that the students know why at Purdue, probably far more even than I do. Purdue fancies itself accurately to be the cradle of astronauts. And we like to think of it now too as they also say cradle of basketball, and hopefully that'll play out this week. But also we like to think of it now as the cradle of tech diplomacy. When you think about where technology happens around the world, but particularly in the United States, your mind almost automatically goes to Silicon Valley. I would argue that that is not necessarily where one's mind should go. And when you think about diplomacy, you immediately think about Washington, D.C. or New York. Okay, but America and the role that the United States plays is more than just the role that's played on these two coasts of the United States. Mitch Daniels often says, and I often echo, that the Switzerland of the United States is West Lafayette, Indiana. And this is the place that's neutral ground where stuff is created, where technology is built and is built upon. And so there was a natural reason to have it here at Purdue. But I think also the welcoming nature that I hope, Mr. Ambassador, you've seen since coming here to campus, the welcoming nature that we have here at Purdue is something that makes it a very natural place to have as our foothold in Switzerland.
Thank you, Director Glick. We have Professor Gorde, who has a question for us.
And as I have traveled back to India from time to time, I have become used to the Gore, which was my name growing up, but it's become Gore in this country. I'm an immigrant from India, but the thought I had, and this is something great that our president, Mitch Daniels, has done here at Purdue. Very early in his presidency, he made an executive decision that students at Purdue will own the intellectual property rights to their discoveries and their inventions. The question, Honorable Mr. Ambassador, I would have is, you talked about innovation in Brazil and particularly educational institutions and their collaborations with Purdue, including my colleague, Professor Fabio Ribeiro's center. What are the intellectual property rules, laws that apply to students in Brazilian universities, and how do you encourage their discovering new ideas and inventions and filing for intellectual property?
Professor Gore, thank you very much for that great question. Look, I'm glad to report, we're talking about startups and so on. Brazil just passed a new law to address exactly your concern. It's called the Startups and Innovation Law. It's passed just by Congress last year. And it addresses many of the questions pertaining to how you streamline, you know, intellectual property protection and regulate specifically how, you know, public institutions, private institutions, and students might interact with that. I cannot tell you that it's exactly the same as you have here in at Purdue University under the leadership of President Daniels, but I can tell you that it's been considered one of the most advanced legislations to promote innovation, to support the startups, including, you know, the activity of researchers and students.
Wonderful. Do any of the students in the audience have a question? Be thinking. I want to make sure we include you if you would like to engage with the ambassador directly. Mr. Ambassador, a nation oftentimes has two fundamental tools that are at its disposal to influence the behavior of others. One being diplomacy, right? The other being, I'll call it a state of force. Right? Through the Department of State in the U.S., through the Department of Defense, if you will, in the U.S. context as well. Recently, we've been hearing a lot about the use of technology in the latter, right, in the use of force. But I'm wondering if you might, again, focus us on the former, right, on the diplomatic side, and give us perhaps some examples of how tech diplomacy has been useful in your experience in conflict resolution or bringing people together, right, humanitarian reasons, if you will.
Yeah, great question. Yeah, that's, you know, very much in everybody's mind. Let me tell you this. I mean, you're talking about the distinction between the hard power, soft power, and technology, specifically on diplomacy. It's been a great tool for us in many respects. For instance, let me give you some concrete examples. The ability you have through social media, for instance, to interact with Brazilian communities, and this, of course, applies to any country, you know, through our consular network and addressing the concerns of specific communities in a timely fashion. It's fantastic, something you cannot dream before if you were doing it before you had social media or email or whatever. At the same time, I like to highlight when I talk about technology and diplomacy about the challenges that it brings to us, to our activity. So I'm a career diplomat. I've been doing this for 37 years. You can imagine that in the early 90s, when I posted abroad for the first time in our embassy in Washington, D.C., the internet was still a nascent animal, it was different. We worked more with written sources, newspapers or physical things, and you got the printout of the hearings on Capitol Hill and so on. And I'd say that it poses many challenges. Perhaps the biggest one, as much as it is useful, nobody's going to dispute that, especially at this place and at this talk. But one thing that we miss sometimes is for a long time, diplomacy, foreign policy, had its niche, its protected space, its bubble space, if you will, because diplomacy deals with what is more permanent in terms of the interests of a country, deals with more perennial, fundamental, unchangeable values. What does Brazil stand for? Not today or tomorrow, but for a long time. What is the history of the country? What are the values you defend, and so on? So, domestic politics wouldn't interfere too much with foreign policy. It's kind of protected. Online communication, social media, et cetera, ended that world. It's over. It's not that it's ending. It ended a while ago. It was just realizing the effects right now. And you saw this in this country, and we are seeing it around the world, how the connection between what's going on in domestic policies, which are day-to-day, what's going on the Hill today, you say, in this country here, in foreign policy, what's going on in the State Department today? Well, it's been going for a while, right? One thing interfering with the other, I'd say this brings tremendous challenges for our activity, for diplomacy, to be as effective as it is. I'm not arguing let's go back to turn the clock back, but I think we need to at least have clarity about the division between what's, the longer term objectives, the permanent interests, and what's more, passing, will not be here in a couple of months or years.
Director Glick, I'm wondering if you have anything to add, given all of your background, and we could talk about challenges too that you might see as well.
Sure. I mean, I think this era that we're living in now, and now by now, I mean today, we're seeing in real time in Europe. I know that's not the subject today, but we're seeing in real time misinformation and disinformation at play in a live war. And that's the use of technology, for good or ill, as the ambassador was saying. We're learning information, but we're also suffering from a barrage of disinformation. And it's hard for people to separate out what is real, what is going on, and what is this massive disinformation campaign from an aggressor. So the world is complex. Technology in a university setting, in a laboratory, by and large, is designed for good. As we saw from the ambassador's presentation, all of these things are advances. And yet at the same time, one of the aspects that we see with tech diplomacy and technology being at the fore is that it can be turned on its head. And that is something that we have to be cautious about.
We've got some hands that have come up. I'm going to invite this young woman here, and if you might introduce yourself to the ambassador as well.
Hi, nice to meet you. My name is Juliana. I am a PhD student from Brazil, and I'm doing my PhD in seismic stability of lunar lava tubes. And I just heard about this innovation that related to NASA, that it's where I get my data from. So I'd like to know if there is some connections between the interests of Brazil, having some connections with professors here, or how can I contribute to bring this technology to my country while I'm doing my PhD here?
Wonderful, Juliana. Glad to see you, to have a Brazilian studying. What you said, you study seismic?
I'm a PhD in civil engineering, but my focus is underground structures. So I'm studying the lava tubes on the moon. So it's seismic stability of lunar lava tubes.
Yeah. Fascinating. I think, you know, we have what was mentioning about the Artemis project and Brazil joining this. That's the sort of thing that we need to bring, you know, research that's being done here by, in this case, a Brazilian at an American institution. And, you know, there's research, and it seems, you know, kind of very unique what you're doing. But I'm sure there's a connection to very practical applications of that. And that's the beauty when technology, you know, comes to fruition. And we are here. We are ready to work with Brazilian researchers, be it through our diaspora initiatives, be it directly contact us to see how perhaps you could join these projects that we're talking about. There might be a connection there with what we were talking about, exploration of minerals in the lunar soil. It's one idea, but it's really great to see, you know, a Brazilian young lady like you studying here in such a specific area, civil engineering. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I saw one more hand come up. I believe that is Dean Shively.
Hi, Jerry Shively from the College of Agriculture. Thank you for the remarks. Really enjoyed them. We're very lucky because we have a veteran of U.S. Agency for International Development with us. And you may want to speak to this, but my question is directed at the ambassador. As Brazil emerges on the global stage as a force, if you will, both in the technology space, but as a large global economy, I'm curious how the country views its responsibility or its relationship with respect to bilateral and multilateral assistance, especially in the international development space. You've received a lot in the past, and now I wonder how you think about emerging on the other side of that in the years ahead.
Thank you very much for that question, Dr. Shively. It's something that we are, you know, paying close attention to. And as you said, we received so much in the past, we were still receiving. We have ongoing cooperation with so many institutions. And one of the things we're doing, and it's not that we intend to do, we're doing already, is through Embrapra, through this agricultural research company, to bring the technologies we have developed specifically for tropical agriculture to other countries in the world which may profit from this. We have projects in Africa, you know, countries which have sometimes similar conditions to ours. I know that we are already working in Mozambique, for instance, and Angola, and you know, other African countries, not necessarily Portuguese-speaking countries. And we're trying to do things with beyond that. In India, for instance, we had a great presidential visit there over a year, 2 years ago. And one of the things we considered is how can we bring this whole technology that Brazil developed for ethanol? You know, ethanol is alcohol made of sugar cane. Brazil is the largest producer in the world, has developed, you know, lots of technology with that, including this company I visited this afternoon here. They began working with the sugar cane industry and so on. And, you know, things to know about that and why is that important, why it would be great to do that with India and perhaps with China and other big countries around the world is this. A car powered by ethanol, sugarcane ethanol, produces about between 60 and 70% less greenhouse gases than fossil fuels. That's one thing. Second thing, it's a renewable, you know, you can plant the sugarcane every year. It's an annual crop. In Brazil, actually, we do two crops in the same year. But they are doing something new in technology, which, you know, I find very exciting, which is this. You usually use only the stalk of the sugarcane plant to produce the alcohol. The rest you throw out. They develop a technique to use what they call second generation ethanol, which uses the leaves of the plant. So using the stalk and then you use the leaf, and you can increase production by using the leaves between 30 and 40%. Same carbon footprint, same plant, same land, etc. Now using second generation, you're increasing production. But wait, call now and we'll add third generation ethanol on this. It's, you know, it's I was, you know, shocked when I was told this. Well, when do you intend to do this? Oh, we're already doing. What's third generation ethanol? Once you've processed the stalk and the leaf, you have a refuge, which, you know, people usually throw it back on the soil yeah, kind of a fertilizer. Now, they now are putting this into a pool and using some micro agents, biological agents, that turn this refuge into bioelectricity, source of electricity. And this electricity is powering the whole operation of the ethanol farm. So this is incredibly sustainable and, you know, incredibly forward-looking in terms of the environment, climate change, et cetera. But this is something that we are very excited to try to bring to other countries. We don't want to sell more ethanol. We sell a lot and so on. I heard this from the largest producer in Brazil. Said, look, I'm not looking for new markets. We all have, you know, them all. What I want is to teach people how to, you know, use this new technology. So that would be, I think, a great way, Professor, to, you know, to give back. And I'm giving one specific example because I know a bit about that. I did some research, but that extends to other crops and, you know, fundamental crops for some countries, and we're ready to work with them. And sometimes doing trilateral cooperation with American institutions, Purdue, for instance, could be one of them. You know, and we work with the USDA in a, what we call trilateral cooperation with African countries and other parts of the world.
Well, everyone, this has been an amazing... Do we have time for one more question?
I have a question from the chat.
So yes, let's do.
Ask a question. Yes, so professor of agricultural and biological engineering from Purdue, Professor Damendra Saraswat, has a question. It's a little bit specific, but it is, Brazilian agriculture statistics point to a fantastic development story. What could be behind the fact that only two Brazilians have been recognized for their contributions through the World Food Prize?
Good point. Let's change that. Yeah, I'm all for it. Yes. Well, you know that there are many things that play into that, but I think there's, you know, growing recognition of the role played, especially by Embrapa, but by Viçosa, by other centers around the country, which play a role in agricultural research. And we're all for recognizing more those great leaders. We have, I mentioned her by name because I'm a great admirer of our Minister of Agriculture, you know, a woman who came from the sector of agriculture in Brazil. She had her family had a small farm. She was one of the first women to graduate from Viçosa in a class that had 100 men, I think two women, or she was the only one, something like that, you know. And she went on to be a leader of a union leader. She went on to be a private sector, you know, run a big private sector company, always in agribusiness and so on. She was a federal representative in Brazil, now Minister of Agriculture. She's done it all, and she's done it very well. So perhaps she's my candidate for recognition of next prize, food prize.
Oh, Mr. Ambassador, Director Glick, this has been such an enjoyable conversation, and our hour has passed us. So I am going to turn it over to Director Glick for a very special presentation.
So, Mr. Ambassador, just a small token of our gratitude here at Purdue, a small gift to demonstrate the global nature of what we are doing here. Upside down.
It's the Globe and Open on Brazil and the U.S. here on the right page. Yeah.
Exactly, on the Purdue page.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Bonnie. Thank you. Thank you all.
And on that note, many thanks to all of you for being here, to Dean Chung, to Dean Plaut, and all of you in the audience and streaming online with us. Thank you all. Have a great evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much.